Good morning and welcome to St Mary's as we meet to celebrate the Mass. We're in the St Thomas Chapel today as we have come to talk about St Thomas of Canterbury. Thomas of Canterbury is depicted in the statue there, and this altar is dedicated to him, we believe. Some confusion over that. So it's wonderful to be able to use it. It doesn't get used too often these days. As far as today's Mass is concerned, we offer prayer especially for the Sovereign. It was Accession Day yesterday, the anniversary of her acceding to the throne following the death of her father. And so we pray for Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth and for all the royal family. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, the fountain of all goodness, bless our Sovereign Lady, Queen Elizabeth, and all who are in authority under her, that they may order all things in wisdom and equity, righteousness and peace, to the honour and glory of your name and the good of your church and people. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
We'll move on to Thomas, who's the other big character. Of course, there's lots more in the history of the cathedral that we could say, but we'll just pick out these two little stories for now. Thomas is born on the feast of Thomas the Apostle. That was fairly common to name your son after the saint on whose feast he was born. He comes from a fairly aristocratic family. His father Gilbert served as Sheriff of London. They lived off the rental income of their property. At that time, this tells you that they're fairly well off, fairly well connected. He has a patron. He's related to Theobald, who also becomes an Archbishop of Canterbury. So he's connected to some of the top religious posts as well as the top civic posts. And Theobald sort of takes him under his wing a little bit. But Theobald does encourage him to follow a career in the church and in law. He sends him off to Rome to see the Pope at various points. He sends him off to study in Bologna and Auxerre, which are big continental universities at that time. And universities at that time are centres of religious study and canon law in particular in those places. So he gets a top education in law, in church politics, in church governance. Thomas is made Archbishop of Canterbury, Rector of various benefices, Prebend of Lincoln and St Paul's, Provost of Beverley. These multi-parish benefices are nothing compared to Thomas's duties. Note, he's not a priest at this point, let alone a bishop. He has these appointments as a layperson. It's only comparatively modern practice that your rector has to be a priest. So he has all these appointments, which are as much his rising in the secular world, in the civic world, as much as the religious world. He's appointed Lord Chancellor by King Henry II in 1155, and as it still is today, that's one of the top posts in the country. Even today, the Lord Chancellor ranks higher than the Prime Minister. And as Lord Chancellor is in charge of collecting the King's revenues, taxes, especially from landowners, which includes the church and the bishops. So Thomas is in charge of extracting the money due from the church and the bishops. He's got this foot in both church and state, and that becomes important for the later story. In 1162, he's elected Archbishop of Canterbury. He's ordained a priest on the 2nd of June and consecrated a bishop on the 3rd of June. He resigns the chancellorship And actually, Henry didn't want him to do that. He wanted him to retain the chancellorship as well as being Archbishop of Canterbury. And that sort of sets in motion the division between himself and the king, which will lead to what happens later. And in fact, we know that Thomas is clued up about how the church works and how the state works, and Thomas seeks to recover and extend some of the powers of the archbishop. And he really starts setting himself against those institutions that he's just moved out of. And I think that's a lot of the reason why he was honoured as a saint so quickly, was because he put the church before the state. He put his, we'll see later in the story, he put his prayer before the wishes of the king, and he defended that, and he defended his honour of God before the honour of the king. Legal conflict soon ensues. In 1164, he is in self-imposed exile in France. He's sheltered by King Louis VII of France, who has a much closer link with the Pope. Again, this is recurrent in English history. The king would really rather that the Archbishop had less to do with the Pope than he does. But Thomas retains that link to the Pope. He goes to France. The Pope, Alexander III, in fact, sends envoys who work some of the legal business out for him and try to keep the peace between Thomas Becket and King Henry II. Thomas would really rather excommunicate the king and go back and sort of wave his legal authority around. But the Pope says, no, we'll try a more diplomatic approach. And so in 1170, 6 years later, Thomas, having spent some time in a monastery in France, some time living in the civic world, he comes back. A settlement is reached whereby he's allowed to come back to Canterbury. So he remains Archbishop of Canterbury, even though he's in France. He doesn't resign that. So he comes back in 1170. There's been a settlement with the king, and everything is supposed to be all right. And then comes the famous bit of the story that many people will know, if not from your history books, then from Shakespeare or other retellings of it. Following Thomas's return, one of the things that the Archbishop of Canterbury is supposed to have the privilege to do is to crown the king, or in this case, the heir apparent, King Henry's son, who's also Henry. Canterbury doesn't do that. The Archbishop of York does that, along with Salisbury and London. The king goes to them and gives them the right to crown his son heir apparent. Obviously, Thomas Becket doesn't like this very much. He does excommunicate the three bishops over this. Politics, exactly. He excommunicates these three bishops. He continues to wave his legal authority around. He excommunicates various other people. He imposes various other rules and regulations, and that's when this famous line from Shakespeare comes that King Henry says, "Who will rid me of this turbulent priest?" Chances are Henry said something like that. It may not have been those words exactly, but Henry said something which people took to mean they wanted Thomas assassinated because Thomas was in the way of the king's politics. So these four knights, and we have their names, they go off to Canterbury. They try to make Thomas answer his demands, to make a legal representation for himself. Thomas refuses. He proceeds to head to say Vespers with the local monastic community. And as he's coming out of the door, he's between the door into the cloisters The stairs go down into the crypt and the stairs go up to the choir. So he's on the staircase by the door into the cloisters, and the king's, the knights assassinate him. And you can go to that spot. The door is still into the cloisters, the stairs still go down into the crypt and up to the choir, and the little spot has become a chapel, a shrine to Thomas, the spot where he was assassinated. Again, his devotion as a saint is very quickly realised. He's formally canonised only 3 years later, which is very quick for that procedure to happen. He's buried initially beneath the crypt in Canterbury for fear that his relics would be stolen. So in fact, the site of the pilgrimage is hidden away a little bit because of the controversy around the politics that led to his martyrdom. So while the church was very quick to honour him, Canterbury itself was a bit more cautious over the fallout from what's been going on. So he's buried in the crypt. He is later translated. The rear end of the church is enlarged for the purpose. The Trinity Chapel, where he was housed, was enlarged. A separate chapel was created behind that. In his assassination, the scalp of his head was cut off. And the idea was that they would house the scalp in a different chapel to the rest of his relics. That didn't happen in the end, but there is still a chapel, sometimes known as Becket's Crown or Corona, which was intended to be where his scalp was housed. Again, just to tell the story and to allow people to connect with that story, and from the church's point of view, to say, not to blame the state for what had happened, or to blame the king for what had happened, but to say this division between state and church is a sadness, and really, we want the two to work together in harmony, and we'd like that to be the case today. And so, it was especially fitting that it was the anniversary of the Queen's accession yesterday, and we were able to pray for that unity and unity of purpose in our prayers this morning.
In the film of Becket, you know, it's a long time ago, isn't it? I can't remember it that well, but weren't the King and Becket quite friendly at one stage? It was really, and the King was really upset by it all.
They were, and as Lord Chancellor, the two would have worked very closely together. And in fact, one of the things that happened in the king's household was that he would send his children away to be fostered by other noble families. And the son, Henry, whose controversy of crowning caused these events, as a child, he lodged with Thomas. And Thomas Becket actually raised the son, Henry, during his time as before he was Lord Chancellor and then as Lord Chancellor. So no, the two families were very close friends, and that's why that's part of the reason why there was never a blaming of the king for what happened. It was seen as an honest mistake, and this story of the king being misheard has been retold because it's true. Because it was an honest mistake on the part of the knights, on the part of the king, and a sadness that it got to that point where state and church were so opposed that anybody could think the king wanted the Archbishop of Canterbury assassinated.
And the other sons were quite significant in it as well, weren't they? Because there was a lot of rivalry going on.
There was.
With Richard and John. Excuse me.
And in fact, during the turbulent years following Becket's assassination, one of the things King Henry II does is go and make penance at the shrine of Thomas Becket during the revolts of his three sons. he goes to the shrine and he prays there to try and make reparation for what he feels responsible for. So those are the two stories really that we're remembering when we go to Canterbury in 2 weeks' time. The Lord be with you. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and give you his peace. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you now and always.